Thank you, Ursula. That was, can you hear me? I can hear you. That was, I'm so sorry that I actually had to say that the section on where you would have given quotes on aesthetics and also how Tatiana explained Julia's silence without only emphasizing in terms of both the inner and outer, as it were, the psychic and the political and so on, if I understood from your sentence. There are many, I will be as brief as possible, and there are many possibilities of discussion worked into our program. I hope you will be able to speak, just as I've told Sven that he has some things to say which in a response have not come out, but he should express them in the discussion areas. I hope you will say more and especially read the quotations. Now, the I will do here is give some points and then turn it over to Joe. First of all, what I this is completely without pathos now. What I'm trying to think through, and I really need the help of those who know, and to an extent Sven and Luca are on the program. I know them. I don't yet know Lisa and Mika, so I don't quite know how they're going to look at this. But this is not, of course, the traditional philosophical understanding of the Kantian entire structure. But let me put it, and it's sad that I'm only going to say it in a sentence or two, it'll seem terribly vulnerable. But if one looks at the idea, and I'm glad that Marshall Brown, a Germanist, has just written me an email saying that this he found very moving, this description, in an interview I did with Kathy Carruth, which is published in the current PMLA. So if you want a better articulation, please go and look there. I'm just going to say it in a very clumsy way. If one looks at the entire machinery, the entire machine, if you like, of the Kantian system at work, of course, Kant himself would never agree to what I'm just going to say, a fractured reason. He never would agree to this. But we are readers, and a cat can look at a king. So the idea that political practical reason is obliged to say freedom, and because of the subject cannot access pure reason and must work on the analogies of the sense of sense perception. This idea that there is a certain programmed necessity, as it were, to insist on freedom. If one looks at this structure, then it's, and this, I'm saying this without pathos, I'm not trying to say that Kant should trump Gramsci or anything. If one Kant writing in this way, bringing, writing a philosophy of critique, which almost brings philosophizing itself to a crisis, so that, and my first conversation with Lucas Tarantino had something of this in there, and there are other philosophers who have looked upon this with some gentleness, I would say, and even commented favorably, that it almost comes to the idea that it is philosophizing itself, which is an intended, quote, intended mistake, unquote, where the intention is not a phenomenal thing within the subject. And as I said, it will be very clumsy because I can't really explain this. I have thought again and again that if this extraordinarily bold way of perceiving the double bind between knowing and doing, not just knowing and doing, but the practical reason is something like that. Please forgive this vulgarization. If this way, this developed idea could be brought into all of the moments in Gramsci that Ursula has so beautifully laid out, that I don't have to do that work, the idea of I must change myself, when he's talking about psychoanalysis, and then coming to the historical moment when he says, I am now transformed. This idea, taking it away from a mere historical narrative, but you can say that were like mere historicalist kind of bold, but I mean, the one can say that the historical situation, to an extent, shows the fault lines, even in Ramsey's case, I mean, with so developed an intellect, shows the fault lines of the merely humanist notion of how one puts education into a double bind between coercion and the development of conviction. This is shorthand. But nonetheless, this is a relationship that one might want to think through in a longer frame, obviously. As for the actual stuff on Gramsci, I would have said something about traveling theory, because I think it's fantastic in the context of the Italian freezing of Gramsci at the moment that David Friedberg was describing to me in conversation. It's fantastic to open it up into this kind of gendered margins. This is already implicit in the notion of the production of the subaltern intellectual. I can't go there now. But on the other hand, I think at the same time, it is very necessary as that theory travels to the United States and it travels to a certain kind of Britain, not quite the general intellectual atmosphere, that we say again and again that this is not, and Ursula commented on that when she quite correctly said that I'm completely uninterested in essentializing subaltern speech, that this is not permission to go away from the tight description of the subaltern in the historiography essay, or not quite essay, where he talks about the subaltern being the groups that do not achieve the state, that they do not have the abstract structures of the state are not accessible to them. So I think, like most traveling theory, as Edward Said so cannily commented, we have to deal with this fantastic development in an intellectually active way. Then I would have gone on to comment on the extraordinary affinity that I also see between Julia and the NKVD and the so-called madness and so on, and Bhuvaneshwari Bhaduri in Can the Subaltern Speak, with the anti-imperialist terrorist struggles and then her inability to kill and therefore then suicide. This pattern, again, I'm putting it very boldly, but in terms of gendering and in terms of much of Gramsci's critique of the feminine position when he is, and you really, those quotes were wonderful, as he's talking about education, there is much room for discussion there. I don't think I'm going to say anything more except remind some folks in this room that the analysis of Freud's analysis of Dora, of course, is very, Jacqueline Rose has already commented on this, is also striking in that it completely ignores the political activities of the woman he calls Dora. So to an extent, we can go there, but I don't think I want to go there. I want to listen to Joe. But I hope you will forgive the brevity of the remarks on Kant, because they're not generally accepted by by readers of Kant. So I hope the conscience in the audience will help me to understand if it's possible to think the Kant and Gramsci together in that way. Thank you very much. Joe, it's all yours.